So for their benefit, we have to regiment their minds the way an army regiments their bodies, ensure that they're under control, make it very clear that they don't participate in workplace management, and certainly not in the political arena. They're to be outside somewhere. And the dedication with which mm-hmm. this task has been pursued is pretty awesome. Right after the fall of the House of Labor in the 1920s, when American labor really was smashed, and people were privatized and tried to accommodate individually to a most undemocratic America, as Montgomery and others have pointed out. That was a time when there was great awe about the end of history and the utopia of the masters, and it's all over, you know, us good guys have won, everybody else is at our feet, kind of like some of the stuff you read today. And it sort of looked like that, you know, it's pretty much looked that way. Well, a few years later, as you know, the whole thing collapsed, and there was militant working class struggle and all sorts of other popular activism, and there had to be an accommodation. You know, there had to be some kind of accommodation to these unwashed masses who were getting out of line, sit-down strikes and all sorts of things. And there was, indeed. There was this fragile social compact that Doug Fraser referred to was indeed established. It wasn't any gift. You know, it was won by struggle. Meaning the labor laws and the limited social system. In fact, American workers back in the 1930s began to get the rights that had been standard long before, even in much more brutal societies. You read the right-wing British press over the, say, early part of this century, they can't believe how bad American workers are treated. You know, same was true of visitors from Australia and so on.